Republican Governor Rick Scott has launched a pre-election purge of non-citizens from the voting lists. The Justice Department demanded an end to the purge 2 weeks ago for possible violations of the Voting Rights and National Voter Registration Act, but Governor Scott insisted it was legal and necessary.
We know we have almost 100 individuals that are registered to vote that are non-U.S. citizens. Over 50 of them have voted in our elections. I have an obligation to enforce the laws of our land. You don't get to vote in Florida if you're a non-U.S. citizen.
Now Florida is suing the Department of Homeland Security for access to an immigration database to find more ineligible voters, while the Justice Department says it will ask a federal court to stop Florida's purge altogether. It's already been frozen by Florida's county election supervisors of all parties, who say they're concerned over the Justice Department's charges and that state data already used to remove voters was flawed. And though Republicans insist President Obama's economic stimulus was not just flawed, but a failure, new charts published by Business Insider editor-in-chief Henry Blodgett tell a different story, a good one for the president. Key economic indicators, including gross domestic product, household net worth, the sum of all family assets, private sector payrolls, retail sales, and the 1%'s favorite number, corporate profits, all began to recover once the stimulus was in place. But is that a story the president can use to win re-election? Democratic strategist James Carville and a team of pollsters say he can't win middle-class voters merely by looking back. And I quote, "Middle-class voters know we are in a new normal where life is a struggle, and convincing them that things are good enough for those who have found jobs is a fool's errand. They want to know the plans for making things better in a serious way." But Democrats do expect some good news out of Arizona tonight, where a special election is underway to fill the seat once held by wounded Congresswoman Gabby Giffords. Polls show Giffords' former aide, Ron Barber, is leading Republican Jesse Kelly by 12 points. Turning first to Florida and the voter list purge, I'm joined by Ari Berman, contributing writer with The Nation magazine and author of Herding Donkeys, The Fight to Rebuild the Democratic Party and Reshape American Politics, and by Mike Papantonio, host of Ring of Fire Radio and president of the National Trial Lawyers Association. Mike, let me begin with you. If it is in fact the case, as Governor Scott claims, that 50 people have been found not to be citizens, then will he not win not only the public relations battle when he goes out to Florida and says, look, I got 50 non-citizens off the voter list, and ultimately won't he win in court when he says, look, as a governor, I've got to do this?
Governor, what he's got is a credibility problem. The moment Scott stepped into the governor's office, he had a monstrous believability problem because of the $1.7 billion federal fraud case that the feds brought against him before he became governor. Those chickens have come home to roost on this voter purge issue. He's not believable. Even low-information voters are having real big problems with it. There's nobody who really believes that this is anything but a scam when they really analyze the facts. But even beyond that, people who don't know all the facts sense that something's wrong. And here's the reason. Today he stated definitely that he found 50 names of illegal voters in this voter purge effort. But that started, Governor, from a list of 182,000 that he also told the Florida public was the problem. And then when he was caught fabricating that story, journalists then looked into it. And when he said that really the number was really only 1,700, journalists looked into that, people like Ari,
Mike,
and they came out.
Mike, let me jump in here for a second. I'm going to play judge in this one. You're the head of the trial lawyers. I used to be in the courtroom. The problem I've gotten, you know, I'm with you ideologically. I don't like what I view as a purge. I think that Governor Scott is doing this in a way that violates our sense of what the Voting Rights Act calls for. Nonetheless, he stands up in court, or his attorney general stands up in court and says, wait a minute, judge, we found 50 people who shouldn't be there. We're not doing anything other than asking for additional information. Ari, tell me why in the court of public opinion he won't at least have a leg to stand on to continue this effort.
Well, first thing, he lost the public relations battle to begin with, so it's going to be hard to get the public back on his side when 2-1 they already disapprove of what he's doing. And this was a list of 2,600 names that were all supposed to be non-citizens. He needs to have 100% success rate here. So he says, oh, I have 50 people who may or may not have voted. We don't know for a fact that they voted. That's what he's claiming. The people themselves are saying, we didn't vote. That's a very, very, very small percentage of the total non-citizens that were supposed to be on his list.
Look, the three of us, I think, will agree, and I've been there when I was AG and governor, the issue of voter fraud really Are there occasional examples? Of course there are, but it is de minimis, not really an issue that merits the attention it gets, even though any one vote, as we all know, is that it shouldn't be cast, shouldn't be there. Having said that, it does strike me that if you have 50 names, then he's going to have a slightly more credible argument as he goes forward. He's going to be able to say, look, something should be done. Mike, when does the Justice Department file its case? When do they get an injunction? What happens next?
Well, I mean, they're full tilt right now. You have Perez, who's an assistant attorney general, that understands it's just a matter of finding a judge to hear these facts, and it's going to be shut down. I really do believe that. I think what you have is a governor, Governor Scott, working against the wind. He knows he's working against the wind. What he's not doesn't seem to follow here, Governor, is that every day he does this, his favorability ratings continue to fall. And you know what? They found that those favorability ratings are falling directly related to this story. So I don't think that, I think the DOJ is in a, they have the high ground here. They're in a perfect position. When they want to move, they're going to be able to move in a big way. I don't ever think it'll get to the point of bringing federal marshals down here, because even his, everybody surrounding Rick Scott that has a brain right now is saying, Governor Scott, you really, really are messing up. You're way out of bounds. And people have also figured out that there's more to the story. This is an effort to purge that 1% in this state, just like they want to purge 1% in 9 other states to have Obama have be a one-term president. So there's a lot more to this story.
Mike, hate to interrupt, but there's a backdrop here that we all are conscious of. Of course, to Florida 2000, where the hanging chads, the fact that that election, whatever you may have thought at the time, the record is clear that that was an election that was not counted properly. We will never know probably who really won that the outcome there. But there's also a history in terms of voter purges in Florida. Ari, what is that history?
Well, this, as you mentioned, this is not happening in a vacuum. This is happening in Florida, a state that wrongly kicked 12,000 voters off its rolls in 2000. That was 22 times the margin of victory for George W. Bush over Al Gore. That list was 41% of African Americans. We know African Americans supported Gore over Bush by 86 points in Florida in 2000. So that purge alone could have made the difference in the 2000 election. Now it's repeating itself in 2012, and people are rightfully concerned anytime you talk about Florida and voter purges that history is going to repeat itself.
And I think, again, the issue here that we've got to focus on is that there are answers to this that would remove this from the partisan context of a governor trying to purge the list fewer than 90 days before a primary. There are technological answers in terms of having a unified voter list that would be precise, that would be accurate. It could be done, but there's been opposition, primarily from the Republicans, in terms of having national legislation that would permit and indeed require that. Something we should discuss more down the road. Mike Papantonio, National Trial Lawyers Association president and Ring of Fire radio host, thanks for some of your time tonight.